Greetings, my brothers and sisters. We're excited this morning about sharing with you in worship. We thank you for joining us today and being a part of our worship experience. As always, we're just excited about the mere fact that God has woke us up and started us on another day's journey. And that's enough right there to be enthused about. For I believe that every day brings with it its own new mercies and its own new blessings. And with that, great opportunities for God to do amazing things in our lives. We say to you often that you could have chosen any place of worship, but we're delighted that you have chosen us to share with us in our worship experience. Anything that you do that add to us always lift us higher and make us feel extra special. So we do pray today that as we move through this particular worship experience, that you are blessed indeed and that you are blessed in a way that your cup runs over and you're able and willing to share what you have gained and gleaned with a friend. We do want to encourage you that we're still in the COVID pandemic and we're experiencing a new variant. We want you to be encouraged to wear your masks. We want you to be encouraged to do the social distancing, to continue to wash your hands and sanitize your hands, because we want you to be safe more than anything else. God has promised us life and we want to enjoy it to the fullest of every measure. We thank you and we praise God for you. Remember that we are open in our worship experience, but you do have the option to continue to view us via YouTube or our Facebook option. Or you can decide to come to the 428 West Northside Drive. We would love to have you in any way a part of us, and we thank God for you. So let us get moving this morning as we continue to experience the joy of God and hope that you're able to latch on to it if you have not already begun. We want to share with you this morning our scripture reading for today, and it comes from the book of Job. And I want to begin our reading at verse number 1 of chapter 2 and commence our reading at verse number 10. I will be reading for your hearing a King James Version of the Bible, and that is again a King James Version of the Bible, Job chapter 2, beginning at verse number 1 and commencing at verse number 10. Hear ye the word of God. Again, there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan came also among them to present himself before the Lord. And the Lord said unto Satan, from whence comest thou? And Satan answered the Lord and said, from going to and fro in the earth, and from walking up and down it. And the Lord said unto Satan, hast thou considered my servant Job, that there is none like him in the earth, a perfect and upright man, one that feareth God and escheweth evil, and still he holdeth fast his integrity, although thou movest me against him to destroy him without cause. And Satan answered the Lord and said, skin for skin. Yea, all that a man hath will he give for his life. But put forth thine hand now and touch his bone and his flesh, and he will curse thee to thy face. And the Lord said unto Satan, behold, he is in thine hand, but save his life. So went Satan forth from the presence of the Lord and smote Job with sore boils from the sole of his foot unto his crown. And he took him a potsherd to scrape himself withal, and he sat down among the ashes. Then said his wife unto him, hear this, dost thou still retain thine integrity? In other words, do you still have a confession in God? Do you still desire a relationship with God? Curse God and die. But he said unto her, thou speakest as one of the foolish women speaketh. What? Shall we receive good at the hand of God, and we not receive evil? And all this did not Job sin with his lips. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be unto God. May we now enter into prayer with the Lord. I always encourage you that if you have anything that you desire God to do, then ask him. But here are the key points. If you don't want him to do it, then don't ask him to. But if you decide that I'm going to ask him, I'm asking you to believe with all your heart that God will do just what you requested. And if there's just an ounce of disbelief, make that a part of your altar call. Help me with my unbelief. So I encourage you, bring it to the Lord, cast it upon him, for he cares for you. And he says that we have not because we ask not. And when we ask like we don't believe. So, hey, know that God can do anything that you ask him to do. May we pray. Eternal Lord God, our Father, we come this morning and we give you thanks for awakening us to see a brand new day. Here in Mississippi, today, we're experiencing snow, the wonders of your work. There's a part of us that have it and a part of us that don't. But it shows us that God, that you can do different things in different places and yet sit on the throne and rule as a supreme sovereign being. We thank you for that today because we know that there's none like you in all the earth. We know that there's no one who rules like you rule. There's no one that has the power that you have. Now there's one, neither is there one that give grace like you give. And you have told us in your word that our mercies are new every morning. Here we stand, January the 16th, 2022, never to see it again, but we have unusual mercy because it's brand new to us on this day. We thank you for your wonders and we thank you for your works that are in our lives and how you have groomed us, how you have grown us, and God, how you have sent us forth to be a testament unto you, to show unto the world what God can do with his people. We thank you for making us instruments and we thank you, God, for accepting our availability. We thank you today, oh God, for making it possible that we, through all that we've gone through, is able to still stand. It's not because our strength, not because our might, not because of our wisdom. It's because you are our God, the one who protects us, the one who provides for us, the one who gives us his presence, and the one with his power that set hedges about us and that protects us from all hurt, harm, and danger, that seen and unseen. We praise you for being all-knowing God. We thank you again this morning for your wonders and your works. And we ask you today, would you heal our infirmities? Would you heal our diseases? Would you open doors for us that we cannot open and close those that are necessary to be closed? Because we only want what you desire for us to have. And we only want to be what you desire us to be. And God, we just praise to you today, pray to you today that your glory be revealed in us. None of ourselves. But that all of you would be revealed. Even in our suffering, may your glory be revealed. In our pain, may your glory be revealed. In our mishaps and in our brokenness, may your glory be revealed. Because you are the God that makes a difference in the lives of your people. We're asking you always to be with us, to comfort us, to strengthen us, and to deposit into us what we need that is so valuable and so vital for us to continue in this journey. We thank you for having hope in us. We thank you for believing in us. We thank you more than anything for trusting us with this word of treasure that we may make visible the Lord our God unto humanity that is seeking. And may God, as they look upon us, may they see you and may they also seek your face and come to you and find what we found and that their borders may be expanded. We trust you today with our lives and asking you to make them better, to make them greater, but more than anything, make them a model for what you desire us to be. We thank you again for 428 West Northside Drive and all of our worshipers that gather with us. We pray that you will bless them where they are and everything that is attached to them in their spirit of promotion, in the spirit of God, of desires and wants, in the spirit of they are crying out to you, lamenting that you, God, would prove yourself to be everything that we need, no matter how big or small. We thank you and we bless you in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Spirit. Amen and amen. We always walk away from our prayers saying amen, but I want you to understand the phrase amen means I agree And it also means that I agree so much that I walk forward to the things that I have requested. So we want you now to be encouraged that what you've asked him for, to look forward to it and let your actions reflect the same. Let us prepare now to go into our word this morning. And our word this morning shall be taken from the book of Job, again, chapter 2. But our text shall be coming from verse number 9 and verse number 10. Very interesting story. But we want to jump in at verse number 9 and verse number 10 from Job chapter 2. Again, I'll be reading from a King James version of the Bible, and these are the words that we shall find. Then said his wife unto him, "Dost thou still retain thine integrity? Curse God and die." But he, Job speaking, said unto her, "Thou speakest as one of the foolish women speaketh. What? Shall we receive good at the hand of God, and shall we not receive evil?" In all this, did not Job sin with his lips? I want to speak this morning from the subject of dying is not an option. Dying is not an option. As you listen to this particular message, I want you to be encouraged through the things that you are going through in life, the things that you're experiencing. I want you to have a full capture of what your, a caption of what your life is about. That your life is not measured by moments, or the fullness of your life is not based on a particular event, but rather that story in full is from the moment that you was conceived up to the moment where you are. And there is a consistent theme that has been going on through your life. Whether you're a believer or unbeliever, you should see consistently the hands of God upon you that has been working with you, that has been pushing you, that has been encouraging you, that has been fanning for you, that has been calling you to a place that greater, that is greater, that is greater than the place that you are now in. I want you to know, and I say this so often, that no matter how wonderful the moment now is, God is calling you to a moment that is greater than that. I want you to believe with all of your heart that no matter how wonderful it is now, that God has something more outstanding for you in the days ahead. I want you to get just the backdrop of this story as we talk about dying is not an option. I know you're saying, well, wait a minute, dying is not an option. We're all going to die. Certainly we're all going to die, but we don't have to die in our spirits before God takes our breath. So that's what we're admonishing you today, is to not let your spirit die, not let your faith die, not let your hope die, not let your will die, not let your expectation from a God that can do anything except fail. Don't let it die. We're presented with a storyline in the book of Job about a man who was very wealthy, a man who had his family life together. It tells us in the book of Job, this particular man, in verse number 1 of chapter 1, he says that he was a man in the land of Uz. And he says also that he was a perfect and upright man, one that feared God and he shunned off evil. I want to give a point of clarity when we look at Job. When the word says that Job was perfect, it was not saying that Job had no errors in his life. It did not mean that Job does not have any flaws in his life. It means that Job was a good man. Not necessarily in literal sense perfect, but in a sense that Job was good. What's the difference, you're saying, then, between good and perfect? I want you to know this, that a good man, when he falls, he realized, I've made a mistake, but I'm not gonna stay here. I'm gonna get up and I'm gonna realize that my failure is a process of elimination, that I know that it doesn't work this way, but I'm encouraged to try it a new way. He also acknowledged that I am responsible for my actions. We oftentimes say, well, the devil made me do it. Did he really make us do it? We have to realize that if we will to be good, that our actions have to be good actions. It does not mean that every day we're going to hit a home run, but we ought to get on base. We're not going to always hit a grand home run, but we ought to get on base. So Job, being a good man, Job knew how to treat his neighbor. Job knew how to entreat his family. Job knew how to treat his wife. Job knew how to encourage his children. Job knew how to be a blessing to those that were around him. Job knew how to comfort those who needed comforting. Job knew how to visit those who were in prison. Job knew how to know that, listen, it's not just about me, but all that I'm experiencing is the Lord's doing, and that I have more than enough. And what God has given me, I should be willing to share that with others. The next thing they say, he was upright. Even though Job was treated wrong, Job didn't treat you wrong back. Even though that Job was lied on, it didn't mean that Job lied on you. Even when Job was perhaps let down by his friend, he didn't go chasing them down to say, I'm going to get him, because of his pride. Job was upright. In uprightness, Job said, the most pleasurable thing for me is not vengeance upon my friend, but my relationship with God staying intact. Just a little bit more about Job. He was one that feared God, not in a sense of trembling. But Job had a high respect for God. He saw him as holy. He saw him as righteous. He saw him as sovereign. He saw him as a God that was a creator. He saw him as a God that worked in his best interest as he worked in the interest of those that were around him. Hear me now. Job feared God because not only was Job blessed, but Job's wife was blessed. Job's children was blessed. Listen, how many children did Job have? Job had 7 sons and 3 daughters. Out of 10 children, Job saw that there were 11 people outside of Job, right in his house, being blessed. That fear didn't mean that he was afraid of God, but that fear mean he respected God. And he honored God for not only what he was doing in his life, but what he was doing in the life around him. I have a question for you at this moment. Have you ever just sat back and looked at your spouse and looked at your children and looked at your house and just somehow folded your arms and said to God, you are wonderful to me? Have you just looked at God in a way that to know that your children are well because of him, that things in your house are well because of him? And if they're not well, that God can make them well because of him. Sometimes I look at my life and I look at the things around me and I say, God, you are simply just amazing to me because I have so many things around me that I do not deserve. It's a wonderful thing to have children to walk up to you and embrace you for being whoever you are, without prejudice, without being partial, but to say, because of you, the gift that you are to them, that they appreciate it and that they are thankful for it. It tells us about Job. Not only does it tell us about that, but it tells us that Job's social status, his economic status. Listen at this. It said that Job had 700 heads of sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 teams of oxen, and 500 asses or donkeys. It goes on to point out early on that Job was very great, that he had a very great household. And watch this. He's the greatest of all men in the East. Now, to some of us who say in sports that he's the GOAT, Job is the greatest of all time. Job is the greatest in his region, in his territory, because there's none that the text tells us is that compares to Job. Job has enough going on with him, and he's blessed with servants. He's blessed with possession. He's blessed with property. There's none in the East, in all of the territory, that compares to Job. Now, what was very interesting to me about this particular text, as I began to reread chapter 1, I was saying, man, with all of this that Job has going on, in our modern day society, we were asked the question, why do I need God when I have all of this going on? But I want you to know that when we have that kind of spirit, when we take pride in our possession, when we take pride in what we own and who we are and how much money we have and how the community look at us, that we can be very tempted to move towards a spiritual death. Because when we begin to think that way, we begin to cut the cord of our source, and our source is God. So we have to realize that no matter how abundantly blessed we are, that it is God who has caused the rain to fall in our lives. No matter how abundantly blessed we are, it's because God has said, I can trust you. And we have to pass that trust test. It's not that God has to be trusted with it, because all of it belongs to him. But can we be trusted with it? That's why I say to people oftentimes, I give the way I give. I sow the way I sow. I share the way I share, because I want God to know you can trust me. Even when it looks like it's running low, I'll still be a blessing, because I trust that you know the measure of my cup. You know what I need to be sustained. You know what I need to survive, and that God, I trust you that you will take care of every one of our needs. One of the things I want to move into is a point now of that Job saying that dying is not an option, is that we bring ourselves to a particular place where we find Job in this story with all of these great things going on. And some will look at Job and say, Job got it made. Job has it made. Well, I want you to know that Job does have it made. But it's because Job understands in point number one, he understands the value of being a worshiper. See, having it made is not meaning that all the dots connect and all the T's are crossed. Having it made does not mean that your bank accounts are swollen, that everybody loves you. Having it made means that, listen, I understand the value of being in the presence of God. Job was saying that to him, that we have to understand that for me, God is all I have. I want you to understand that as Job moves to a particular story, we have to look back in order to get to where we are. And what I want to look back at is this, that Job has been recommended by God to go through a test. What? Job has been recommended by God? Yes. The upcoming events in Job's life is because God allowed it to happen, because God made the arrangement with Satan. Hear the storyline. The elders, they come, the sons of God come to present themselves to God on a particular day. And Satan also comes among them. Chapter 1, verse number 6. And the Lord notices that Satan is there. Satan appears in this presentation, and God begins to engage him in communication. In verse number 7, and the Lord says to Satan, not to the sons of God, but he says to Satan, whence comest thou? And Satan knows that God knows the truth. He answered honestly that, listen, God, I've been going back and forth in the earth. I've been walking up and down it, because God knows Satan's heart. He knows that he's not for any good will. So Satan, you've been walking around trying to seek whom you may devour, seek whom you can destroy, seek whom you can distract. See, you're trying to find out who you can ultimately kill. Knowing Satan's heart, God asked Satan the question, Satan, have you considered my servant Job? I want you to notice how God introduces Job. My servant Job. Not just Job, but one who serves me. One that I know, and one that knows me well. He says to Job, says to Satan, have you thought about him? Have you considered him? There's none like him in all the earth. Listen to how God describes Job to Satan. He's a perfect and an upright man, one that feareth God and one that avoids evil. Job doesn't get into street talk. He don't get into hearsays. He don't get into the rumors. Job deals with facts. Job knows what is important. And that's one of the points that I shared with you last week about being resilient, that we got to know what's important, because when we discover what's important, we know that's where we invest our time and our resources and our talent. Because if it's not important, why are we giving it any of our attention? If it's not important. So Satan says to God, well, I miss Job, but let's talk about him. The only reason that Job really loves you, the only reason why Job really respects you the way he does, would you agree with me, God? It's because you put a hedge about him. Not only about Job, but you put a hedge about his house. And not only that, but on every side of him have you put a hedge. In other words, you are Job's protector. Thou hast blessed, watch this, the hands, the work of his hands. Now that right there knocked me off my feet. When Satan says to God that you have blessed the works of Job's hand.
You have caused Job to prosper.
And it's strange that Satan acknowledges it, but we have a tendency to feel like we've done it. We have a tendency to think that if it wasn't for my background, for my education, for the people that I know, for the work ethic that I have, that I wouldn't have all of these things. But Satan says to God, and he says to us very clearly, it's because you've blessed his hands. Man. And he goes on to say, and the substance is increased in the land. And as his substance is increased, his border has been expanded because you made it happen. One of the things that I need us to understand is that, listen, whatever good that has happened in our lives, that God has caused it to happen. Whatever it is that has your heart flooding with joy and you just overwhelmed by the bounty of it, it's because of God. And Satan helps us to see this. The only reason that Job is blessed the way that he is and have all the things that he have. Again, 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camel, 500 teams of oxen and 500 donkeys. Is because you bless his hands. The footnote I want to give you here is that you can labor, but unless God is on your side, you're just laboring. But if God is on your side, man, your labor turns into luxuries. Wow, that's awesome. So, hey, here's the thing. Notice that when he says to him, and I'm trying to build our background to get us where we need to be, he says to Job this, he says to God this, that the only reason is because you blessed him this way. But check this out. But if you put your hands on him now and touch his possession, he will curse you to your face. What is Satan saying to God? That a man loves his possessions. If you take away his social status, if you take away his economic position, if you take away the prosperity of his life, then that man, God, will curse you to his face. God says, I tell you what, I'm confident in Job. I trust Job. I know Job. I've seen Job. I've seen him. Have your way with him. And Satan goes and have his way. But I want to stop right there and ask, what did God notice about Job? That he was able to say to Satan, go ahead on, because I know our relationship is stronger than that. Well, here it is. In chapter 1, it tells us that Job, he worshiped God always. And because of his children, that Job rose early in the morning to engage with God. He got up early in the morning, made it the first order of his business that he would go in and that he would sanctify himself and that he would be able to sanctify the children. And he offered burnt offerings for them all the time. Because Job said, perhaps there's something that my kids have done that has not been pleasant in the sight of God. So I will worship God for him or for them. Job realized that, hey, what we need to know is this. That, hey, worship is essential to one's being. If we're going to know God and God is going to know us, it's through worship. Notice I did not say praise, because worship is more intimate. Worship is a place where you're relaxing. It's where you are meditating, where you are wondering and pondering on the word of God. You're thinking through what the scriptures is saying to you and you are lining it up. When it says that for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. When you're in worship, you think about that and you say that, hey, am I not a part of the world? Am I not a part of God's creation? And God loved me that much that he gave me his son that I might be saved. Watch verse number 17 of John 3. He said, God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through his son might be saved. When you get into worship, you begin to appreciate the fact that God saw me in a mess, but he did not leave me there. Because of his love, he gave me the best that he had. When you're in worship, you begin to grow in your compassion for God, because you were saying, if he had not done that, I would be messed up. I would be jacked up. I would still be in a dark place. And you begin to appreciate and begin to have a sense of gratitude that God God wouldn't leave you where you were, but that God would bring you forward to the promises that he has prepared for you. When you're in worship, you begin to understand that God loves me, and that everything that God does, he does it for me. His motive is that my eyes will be open and that my heart will seek him, that I may know him and find fellowship with him. Worship makes me understand that, listen, there is nothing like him. There is no one like him, and there's nothing to be compared to him. Worship gets in my heart and deeper than my emotion. It gets in my soul. It attacks my will. It begins to attack my mind and begins to envelop into a way that it says that, listen, I want to please you. I want to stay right here, and I want to always be abiding with you. Worship will cause us to praise, but worship will make us fall in love. Worship will make us begin to understand his love for us, his dedication to us, his commitment to us, his faithfulness to us. There's a word, hesed, which means that God is faithful and there's nothing to be compared to his faithfulness. He is that for us and has been always for us. So we understand that when God says that I know Job, I know where Job's heart is because I've heard it every morning. I've heard it in his distress. I've heard it when he's been trying to find out, what do I do next? Let me go ahead and put it in a literal term for us. I hear his heart when he's saying, where should I make this deposit? I hear his heart when he's saying, what should I do about this investment? I hear his heart when he's saying, what I should do about this situation? That there's disagreement, but what is my position among this disagreement? I hear his heart when he's saying, my wife is asking for something, but I don't want to do that right now. So God, I don't want to be caught up in myself, but I want you to lead me to make the right choice, even in my marriage. My children, I want you to lead me in making the right decisions for my children. God hears Job's heart every morning, because Job is not only a seeker, but God, Job is the person that's saying, I want you to be pleased in all my being. That's what it means to be a worshiper. It means that even though my hands are up as a sign of surrender, my hands are up in a sign of honoring you, but my hands are up saying, deposit into me what I need. I want to make the right choices. I want to do the right thing. I want to be the right person, not in the eyes of popularity, but I want to be the right person in the view of you as my God. So God was able to recommend Job because he understood where Job was. He understood who Job had grown to be. And Job's worship was greater than himself. I need us to understand, as we talk about Job as a worshiper, that we need to understand that his first tack was about his possession, because that's what Satan puts on the stage. And Job, God is saying to Satan, no, Job is greater than his possession. Take this footnote under the point of God, of Job being a worshiper, and understands the value of being a worshiper. Satan is always after what God has for us. Even Satan is after us because we belong to God. Satan is just simply jealous. He's jealous of our relationship with God. He's jealous of our blessings from God. He's jealous of our love for God. He's jealous of our worship to God. Satan wants what we're giving God. Not that he has anything to do with it. Not that because he intends to grow us from it. I just want it because I don't want God to have it. He wants us to focus on him and be distracted from seeing who God really is. Jealousy is dangerous. Envy is poison. And vengeance is fatal. We need to understand that those are the things and the types of spirit that Satan would put into us and deposit into us. We need to know the difference. That Satan wants us to have possessions in order to buy our loyalty. But God wants us to have possessions that he may bless us. The difference is, Satan wants you to have it to buy you, but God wants you to have it to be blessed. To be blessed. He wants you to have it. Understand this. God is saying that Job will abide in his presence. The story moves on in the narrative that Satan goes and he's allowed to go and attack Job.
I want you to look at verse number 14, just a backdrop. In verse number 14, it says that a messenger came to Job and tell him that all the oxen and the servant that was attending the oxen were gone. How many oxen? 500 teams of oxen. And the servants that were watching them are gone. While he was yet speaking, another one came and said to him, not only are the oxen gone, have they been slain? But he says, listen to this. There came a fire from heaven and burned up all of the sheep, 7,000 sheep, and consumed the people that were with the sheep, the herdsmen that was with the sheep. They're gone. No one was able to escape but me. I'm the only one. While Job was hearing that, I want you to get in your mind that Job is saying, wait a minute, I've lost all of my oxen, and I've lost all of my sheep, and I've lost the servants of my household. I'm sure Job is stretching his head and saying, what in the world? But while this person was finishing up his dialogue with Job, another one came and said to Job, that Job, hey, guess what? That while we were out there in the field, there came some, and they took away all of the camel. 3,000 camels are gone. They've been carried away. And the servants attending them are dead. Job thinking, man, can it get any worse than this? The camel, the oxen, the donkeys, they're all gone. And while Job was thinking and listening, another servant comes to Job and speaking and saying, Job, while your sons and daughters were at the eldest boy's house, there came a wind from the four corners of the world, of the earth, fell upon the four corners of the house. There's a wind that came and smote the four corners of the house. Job, they're dead. And the only person that's left is me. With all of this news and with all of this going on, I'm sure you're thinking, man, if this was me, I couldn't bear it. If it was me, I could not take it. If it was me, I don't know what I would do. I would go out of my mind. But the question is not just what you would do, but what is it that this person that God has recommended to Satan, what does he do? The person that God trusts, what does he do? The person that God has gotten to know through worship, what does he do? We're not left in the dark. It tells us when Job hears this news in verse number 20, it said that Job rose up. Job tore his clothes. Job shaved his head. And Job fell to the ground. And the last word in verse number 20 snatches my spirit to a place of great respect. It says, Job worshiped. When the world seemingly in its automatic response would cry, travail, lament, be torn, be hysterical, just go crazy, Job gets up from his place. He tears his clothes as a point of grieving. He shaves his head as a sign of mourning. And Job falls to the ground as a sign of his posture, and he worships God. Hear the words that comes out of Job's mouth in verse number 21. Naked, I came out of my mother's womb. Naked shall I return thither. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. That's real worship. What do you mean by that being real worship? Job did not allow his worship to die. Let me tell you something. When things like this come and we begin to ask the question, well, what more do I have to live for? God scoots to the edge of his seat and Satan stands on his feet. And began to applaud. Because you got to understand what I said early on. Satan wants what God has. He has no real purpose for it. He has no real thing to do with it. He just wants what God has. And what he wants is you from God.
So that's why we have thoughts of suicide. That's why we have thoughts of saying our life is no longer worth it. That's why we look at things and the value of life has been placed upon events and people and persons and these particular things and popularity and being loved from whomever that we want to be loved by. No, that's a trick of the enemy. He wants us to realize, he wants us to come to some realization that this is what your life is really about. But God is saying, no, that's not what your life is about. Your life has been about worship. Your life has been about honoring me. Your life has been about our fellowship with each other, because what you have gotten and what you have experienced has been because of me. Not just you alone.
I think that Job digs in all of his distress and all of this dilemma that he has and all of this disaster that he's experiencing. I think that Job digs deep into his soul and he worships God. Job said, if all of this is going on, I have nothing left but my worship. So Job sees the essentialness of keeping his worship alive. Job, what do you mean by keeping his worship alive? Job says, nothing else. Let me get to God. Because I can't make it out here by myself. See, the thoughts of suicide is a thought of isolation. It separates you from the folk who remain. Remember, Job's children are dead. His possessions are gone, but his wife is yet alive. So when we're thinking that there's no one but me, there's no one else to love me, that's not the reality. God always has somebody around us to love us. Sure, we've lost, but we have not lost at all. Job says, let me worship him. In other words, let me get to his presence. Let me get to his presence. Why does Job go wants God's presence? Because Job understands that my worship is bigger than me. It's bigger than me. It's never been just about me. It's been in my worship has been inclusive. My worship has been about the things that are dear to my heart, my children. And that's why we should learn to worship God, not just for ourselves, but worship God for our children, worship God for our spouses, worship God for our possession, worship God for all the things that are connected to us. Job worshiped God on behalf of his children, his possession, and his servants. I'm going to go ahead and try to bring this to an end, because I want to pick this up next week and talk about it a little bit more. But I don't want to close without letting you know that your worship remains alive because you understand the value of being in the presence of God. Because it's only God that can give us consolation. It's only God that can give us comfort when our lives are falling apart. Job says to us in this storyline, if you don't get any bigger point than this, that when you've lost it all, the presence of God is where you want to be. When it's falling apart, if nothing else, you want to be in the presence of God. When you have been hurt to the core of your being, the presence of God is where you want to be. And how do I get into the presence of God? It is through worship that I get into his presence. It's in worship that God begins to help things to unfold. It's in worship that God helps me to bear what I think I cannot bear. It's in worship that God gives me the strength that I need. It's in worship that God lifts me up from my desolate and brokenness. So no matter how painful your journey has been, it's the presence of God where you want to find yourself. No matter how bad things, the news is coming after one thing after another, it's the presence of God that you want to find yourself in. You've lost your job. You lost a family member. You've lost a relationship. You're broken because of an experience. You're disappointed in the choices that you made. Where should you run to? To the presence of God. Because it's the only place that's going to give you your worth in discovering that, listen, that it's not over yet, that I'm yet alive. And if God could take away all of those things and I'm still alive, there must be some rationale behind this. And the only place that you're going to find your answers is in worship. The only way you're going to be able to brace yourself is in worship. The only way that you're going to come to some place where you can say that life is worth living another day is in worship.
Job did not make it about his possessions. He did not make it about his popularity. He did not make it about real estate property. He did not make it about his children. Job said that God and I are greater than anything I've ever taken hold of. And if I'm going to continue, it's going to have to be through worship. If I'm going to make it, it's going to have to be through worship. If I'm going to find determination to come out of this dark place, to come out of this pit, to come out of this valley, to come out of this dungeon, to come out of this mess, to come out of it, worship is where I must plant myself. I want to say again, worship is bigger than you. But worship is all inclusive of everything that is attached to you. As we begin to close this message, and next week we'll pick this up on part two, I want you to think about how many times have I gone to God with everything that is attached to me in view and begin to see that God did this for me. Not that I would be bigger than anybody else, not that I would be better than anybody else, but that I would be the best me as an ambassador for the kingdom. That when people look at me, the things that I own is only a representative of who I am in God. The blessings that have been stored upon me is because he trusts me with kingdom things. No matter how broken the people are around me, and no matter how much it appears that their lives are together, God entrusted them in my life because he knew that I represented the kingdom. And if they were not what they were going to be, were supposed to be, that I would help them to get to where they were going to be, that they were going to be. God has confidence in us. Otherwise, you would not experience the things that you've experienced, good, bad, or otherwise. God only allows them because he trusts you with them. Our experiences have not always been with great sunshine or rays. I've not always been met with birds singing in the morning. Sometimes I have opened my eyes to say, oh God, I don't want to face it today. But I could not deny that he had given me a new day. And we'll talk about those things in more significance as we move through. But our first point is that Job said that dying is not an option because he knew the worth of his worship. He understood the value of being a worshiper. He understood that God only allows what he knows we're capable of handling. That's my time this morning. Look forward to you joining us in the days to come. God's blessing be with you and remain with you. Again, as we prepare to exit this message, we encourage you to continue to worship with us, either in location or either live stream, YouTube or Facebook. But we're thankful for whatever choice you make to be a part of us. If you desire to give, we encourage you to give online through our PayPal or through our Cash App, or you can mail in. If you desire to be a part of our fellowship, become a part of our community of faith, we encourage you to come because we've been praying that God would add to us faithful, loving people that would help us to grow and help us to be the best that we can be. Again, thank you and God bless you. Father, we thank you for our time together today. We pray that the words that we've spoken would take good root and bring forth great harvest in the lives of your people. We pray that the ears that will hear this message and the hearts that will receive it, that their lives will be changed. And those persons that are around them, may they have that type of domino effect that God, since I've been touched, I'll touch others. And may the community in which we live and the places in which we exist, may they become ever the more greater because our eyes have been enlightened and that your word of truth has been revealed to us. We thank you and we bless you in Jesus' name. Amen, amen, amen. Peace and blessings to each of you and the love of God travel with you always. All right.